You're listening to the audio production of Unashamed. Drop the baggage, pick up your freedom, fulfill your destiny, by Christine Caine. Published by Zondervan and read by J. O'Shea.
Introduction. I spent the first 22 years of my life shackled by shame. Looking back, I realize I had always felt it. It had been part of my life from my earliest memories. I felt it when I was rejected, made to feel unworthy, of no value. I felt it when I was abused and couldn't tell anyone, and believed it was somehow my fault. I felt it when I tried to hide who I was, apologize for who I was, minimize my talents, or overachieve and compensate for feeling somehow less than. Have you felt it? If you're human, you have, and the result is always the same. Shame makes us feel small, flawed, not good enough, and controlled. Shame is the fear of being unworthy, and it adversely affects our relationship with God, ourselves, and others. It greatly hinders our ability to receive God's unconditional love and share it with others. Because of God's great love, I began to discover the power of God's Word to break through the lies I had believed and to reveal the truth of who I am and why I was created. Notice that the key word in that sentence is began. Breaking free from the shackles of shame is not an overnight experience or a quick fix 10-step process. It is, however, a grand, ongoing adventure of discovering the depths of God's love and the huge scope of God's power to transform us, recreate us, and continually renew us. I am still discovering deeper aspects of those things, after all this time, and I know the process will not end until I meet Him face to face. I wouldn't have it any other way. In fact, writing this book has been one more step on that journey for me, because shame loses its power when it is expressed. I hope that by sharing with you my story, you will open up your heart and allow God to lift the shame off you so you can flourish and become all that He's created you to be. Do you struggle with the fear that you are not enough? Are you afraid to let your true self be seen and known? Are you always trying to gain approval? Trying to prove you are valuable and worthy to be loved? Do you want to break the power of shame in your life? Then join me through the pages of Unashamed to take your first steps in dropping the baggage of shame, picking up your freedom in Christ, and stepping into the fullness of the destiny, the shame-free life God has in store for you. I pray that this book helps you take the next steps on your journey to freedom and equips you to keep taking the next step. As you read, the enemy will be trembling because he knows that once God has broken the chains of our slavery to shame, there will be no holding us back. So many of the things I'm experiencing now I never could have experienced if I'd remained a woman in hiding, ruled by shame. God has been writing a great story in my life of His power to invade and transform a shamed woman into a beloved daughter, a treasured vessel of His Holy Spirit, a vital member of His body at work in this hurting world. He wants to do the same for you. God created you for a unique purpose. He has a specific plan for your life, and He has a powerful destiny He wants you to fulfill. And guess what? Shame has no place in that purpose, plan, and destiny. Jesus came to set you free from shame. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Galatians 5:1. Thank you for joining me as I share my journey from a shame-filled to a shame-free life. My heartfelt prayer is that you too will discover the power of a life lived free. It's the life God originally created for you, the life Jesus died to give you, the life you are worthy to live. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. John 10:10. With much love, Christine. Chapter 1. Schooled in Shame. I've got your lunchbox packed, Christine, my mum called from the kitchen. Come, let me braid your hair. I looked down at my brand new, shiny black shoes, checked that my white socks were evenly folded at my ankles, and skipped from my bedroom to collect the pretty, bright pink lunchbox I'd been allowed to pick out for my first day of kindergarten. I had tried to eat a little breakfast that morning, but couldn't manage more than a few bites. No problem. Who wanted to waste time on breakfast? The big day had finally arrived. My first day of school. I couldn't wait to get there. I fidgeted impatiently as my mum neatly braided my long, light brown hair into pigtails. Then I bounded out of the house, pigtails flying, for the walk to school in the footsteps of my second grade brother. For some children, entering kindergarten is an exciting adventure of new friends, new songs and games, and new discoveries. While for others, it can be a frightening separation from parents and the familiar security of home. I was definitely in the first category, an eager 6-year-old filled with great expectations of good things. I vividly recall taking my seat in the classroom for the first time and wiggling with excitement over the eye-widening, colourful world of bookshelves and chalkboards, a wonderland I was bursting to explore. But what excited me most was all the other children, a whole roomful of new playmates my own age. Until now, I'd seldom played with neighbourhood children, though I had longed to. My playmates had mostly been my brothers or my cousins at family gatherings, so I couldn't wait until outdoor lunch and recess when I could begin to make new friends. Finally, lunchtime came, and we all carried our lunchboxes outside and sat on the asphalt playground. But this is where my warm waves of nostalgic memories give way to a scene that made my cheeks burn red and my heart sting. I chose a spot next to a few other girls and unlatched my lunchbox, happy to find that my mum had packed my usual lunch, a feta cheese and olive sandwich. I was enjoying my first bite when Wayne, a boy sitting nearby, wrinkled his nose and cried out, "Phew! What's that awful smell? What's that stinky stuff you're eating?" Suddenly, all eyes turned to me. Wayne's friend, Raymond, announced to all, "She's eating that Greek cheese." Then he eyed me suspiciously and asked, "Why can't you wogs eat normal food like everybody else? No wonder you all stink like garlic." For a moment, I froze. Then my heart started to pound. I felt my face growing hot. The word he'd called me was a terrible word, a nasty word, an inflammatory racial slur for Greeks never used in my house, though I'd heard it before, spewed angrily by strangers in public places. Why was he calling me this? And my sandwich smelled normal to me, not stinky. Didn't everybody eat feta cheese? I looked around, hoping to see someone else with a lunch like mine, only to discover that all the other kids had something we never ate at my house: white bread sandwiches spread with Vegemite, a distinctly Australian food paste. I felt exposed, an oddity on display, checked out by the puzzled and scowling faces of those who, only moments before, I had assumed were my new playmates. I wanted to disappear. Wayne and Raymond, on the other hand, bolstered by the attention of their newfound audience, grew bolder. "My dad says you people should go back to your own country. You don't belong here." My stomach clenched. I didn't understand what he meant. Go back where? This was my country, wasn't it? I'd been born here in Australia. I'd lived on the same street my whole life. Didn't everyone else at lunch that day all live in the same Australian neighbourhood my family did? Layla Park? Why was he saying I didn't belong? I looked at the other girl sitting alongside me, hoping to find a compassionate expression or reassuring sign, but every one of them looked away, pretending to ignore me. No one was going to come to my defence. I was all alone. More stinging words about my heritage followed, accompanied by snickers from some of the other kids. I sat in silence, eyes to the ground, until Wayne and Raymond finally tired of taunting me and turned away. Obviously, there was something wrong with me, something embarrassing about being Greek. No one else was mocked because of his or her food or family. I was, for reasons I did not understand, strange, different, and unpleasant to them, someone to be avoided. Though my empty stomach rumbled, I'd lost my appetite. I stuffed my uneaten sandwich back into the lunchbox, the pretty pink lunchbox I'd been so excited about earlier, and snapped it shut. The minutes ticked by slowly. I watched longingly as others gathered in little groups and talked and played. But no one spoke to me. I sat quiet and alone, wanting to join in but feeling unwelcome, like an outsider. Relief washed over me when the bell finally rang. On the way back to the classroom, fighting back tears, I secretly pulled my sandwich from my lunchbox and tossed it into the trash can. I never again wanted to be ridiculed for being different. I would try to be like everyone else. I didn't want to be Greek. Was I different in other ways I didn't realize? Did I have an accent? Did I use different words? Was there anything else about me that would make people laugh? From then on, I would try not to say or do anything that the others didn't. The 6-year-old me didn't really have a word that expressed what I felt that day. Since then, I've learned one. Ashamed. Almost every day for the rest of the year, no matter how hungry I was, I quietly carried the lunch my mum had lovingly packed for me over to the trash can and tossed it out. Shame does that. It prompts us to toss away the good gifts we are given. Lessons learned. All I really need to know I learned in kindergarten is the title of a famous book by Robert Fulghum. What he meant, of course, is that kindergarten is where we were taught what is expected of us to get along in this world. Share everything, play fair, hold hands and stick together. But the lesson I learned in kindergarten that day was the lesson of shame. I learned it so well in kindergarten that by first grade, I'd come to expect the daily taunts and jeers, the name-calling and bullying. I'd also caught on to the fact that the hateful graffiti spray-painted on the walls of our housing projects was directed at my Greek immigrant family and me, the only Greeks in our low-income government housing neighbourhood. I had learned through bitter experience that I could do nothing to erase the chasm between my classmates and me. My kindergarten plan to try to blend in had been met with failure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.